I have a measurable function, okay, R, then I can write this measurable function as difference of positive and negative part of it, actually. Okay. So today we're going to begin basically a set of results. We'll prove some lemmas in which we want to do the same thing for a measure, okay, which is not going to be a measure from x to r. It's going to be a map from minus infinity to plus infinity, okay, and then we want to kind of break down the measure into
positive
and negative kind of measure. We want to make rigorous of it, so it's like a pretty much doing things in a very abstract manner. Okay, the tool that will allow us, basically the result that we like to prove, is something called the Hahn-Jordan decomposition theorem. So that's our... So let me begin with a set of definitions, okay, an example. Imagine you have a sigma-algebra. Yeah, sigma-algebra. And assigned measure. Ugly kind of measure, but measure in this sense. Okay. Assigned measure is a map from the sigma algebra, sorry, shouldn't be. Here obviously should be map from sigma algebra into minus infinity, plus infinity. Okay. Why we are excluding minus infinity, there is a whole story behind it. Okay. Maybe discuss it in class, or maybe I refer things to you and you can see it from there. That if you include both ends of infinity, then there will be lots of troubles. So to avoid those troubles, just get rid of one end of the infinity. Then you include minus infinity.
R plus.
R plus infinity, so one of the infinities. and one of the reason would be that, okay, what if you have to add, for example, you know, two sets, two measurable sets with one measure minus infinity, another plus infinity. So if you take the sum of those, that would be a very troublemaking kind of an expression, because what would be the meaning of adding minus infinity to plus infinity?
Right.
Okay. If you exclude one, okay, then, you know, so the situation you can come up with that, okay, you can have two sets with, say, measure plus infinity, but plus infinity added to plus infinity, we know that, okay, in the sense of the standard real line, it's plus infinity. Or something finite added to the plus infinity is again plus infinity. Okay, so we don't want to include both infinities because there can be situations which will be a bit trickier, actually.
Right.
Not problematic. So, just exclude one of them. So, what I'm defining is what you call a signed measure. A signed measure such that it has two properties. Okay, that the measure of the set is zero, and the measure of the union equal to 1 to infinity of pairwise dis algebra is equal to equal to 1 to infinity u of ai at t. Okay? Where this, you know, these guys are from A and they are pairwise disjoint. And ai AI section is J is empty when I does not equal to J. So in other words, if you have a two kind of maps which satisfy these two properties, would be a sign measure.
Okay.
And we are calling it sign for obvious reasons, that obviously now you can talk about, you know,
can we call every
measure being negative or positive or so on and so forth.
Can we say every measure is sign measure?
Every measure is a sign measure, yes. Okay. But with a positive part only. Okay. Doesn't include negative. So now I would like to define another thing and then we'll do an example of this. So here's a definition. That imagine we have a sign measure. Measure, then a set, okay, A from the sigma algebra A is positive, okay, it's a positive set, okay, if you know, for any set of A, so any B, and that B obviously must be measurable, we have mu of B bigger than or equal to 0. Okay. So a set is positive if every part of this set, you know, including itself obviously, has a positive measure. Okay, but that part should be measurable as well. Okay, make sure that the part is measurable so that I'll be a new order. And similarly, I can define negative. I can define that A is negative, okay, if the mu of B is less than or equal to for all B, which are subset of A, and they are measurable. Okay? So you can say that this is, for this all what you call a negative set. And similarly, you can also define something called the null set, actually. Okay. And okay, so that's one definition. The other would be that A, so A is null set if what happens? If mu of B is 0 for all subset of B, and there are those subsets which are measurable. Okay. In other words, a set is positive, negative, or null depending on that each part of that set has a positive
equality quotient.
Okay.
दोनों में एक्यूरेटी होगी
अगर
दोनों में एक्यूरेटी होगी सर पॉजिटिव और नेगेटिव में लेस देन इक्वल
टू इफ यू गेट हाफ
स्ट्रिक्टली
नेगेटिव दैट इज पॉजिटिव एंड नेगेटिव बोथ देन मस्ट बी नल एक्चुअली थिंक
अबाउट
हां सही है यस बिगर देन इक्वल टू लेस देन
ओके जस्ट थिंक अबाउट सो इफ अ subset of A is positive and negative both. Okay? And you take B as a subset of B, then these both inequality will go. And you can deduce this.
So negative or positive and less than equal to
Okay, but if you wish, you can define things in a strict manner, but this is kind of more convenient as well. Okay? So a set, okay, in which you can have many parts. So this whole is also a part actually. And if all these are measurable and this set is positive, then each of these parts must have a positive. And similarly negative and similarly all that sets. Let me give an example. For example, that I cut quick remark. Okay. And you can prove it for yourself. If that the continuity property holds also for sign measure. In other words, the measure of the union, if mu is sign measure, the measure of the union from I equal to 1 to infinity ai is same as the limit m goes to infinity, the measure of union I equal to 1 to n ai. And the proof would be precisely same as we have done, you know, what you call previously. So this sign measure is kind of extending this notion of measure, which was just first restricted to the positive part of real part. Now you want to extend it to the, you know, the whole real line. Let's do an example. Here's an example. All this stuff. Let f be an integrable. Let f be Lebesgue measure. Then what value of this f dm can take actually over any set A, where A is an element of sigma algebra? What potential values it can take?
Positive, negative, zero.
So it can take any value. So it could be positive, negative, depending on what set A is and what f is and so on and so forth.
So, yeah.
Okay. So if I find this guy a name, mu of A. In other words, I define a mu from 0, not 0, but sigma algebra A minus infinity to positive infinity in this manner, that for every mu, for every A from sigma algebra A, when mu is operating into it, it means that you take that fixed function f and integrate it over the set A in the region A. Okay? And whatever number comes as an answer
is measure of it
to the mu of A. Okay? So m is a Lebesgue measure, f is an integral map, and the mu of A is defined in the manner that you integrate the given function f with respect to the measure over the set A, and then mu is a sign measure for obvious reasons. Okay. You can easily prove it. And if I take set P as the collection of the points for which the function is non-negative and n intersection of the points for which the function f of x is negative, then my claim is that P is a positive set and N is a negative set. Can you see why?
Positive, yes. Integral positive will be
so. Yes. So if you take any subset of P, okay, and you integrate it, since on this b the function is non-negative, okay, so the integral must also be non-negative. Okay? And similarly, if you take b as n, okay, then it must be, u of b must be, what do you call, negative vector. Okay? So, what interestingly we can kind of observe is that, you know, you can break down this whole real line into, not whole real line into, but like the, you know, whatever your measurable space is, into essentially two disjoint parts. Okay, I'm gonna comment afterwards on it actually, but. So you can see that for obvious reasons these two are examples of positive and negative sets. If you wish, you can, you know, exclude this bigger, you know, this equality from here, and you can treat, for example, a third set, okay, C, which is a collection of the point x such that f of x is 0, then we can show that it must be a null set at zero. Should be a null set. Think about it.
Discrete.
Because if B is the collection of the points where the function is 0, then the integral would be 0. Okay?
So that set won't be a set. Its measure would be 0.
But we have defined actually a function. Okay? We have defined in a particular manner. Okay? The null set means something that has assigned measure 0. Every part of it has a sign. I would like to add one more thing, and that's an important thing, that imagine I have a set, okay, whose signed measure is negative as a whole. Okay? So sign measure is negative as a whole. Does this only make the given set 0? Or make this set A as a negative set?
No.
The answer is no, actually. In other words, yes. So because if a cumulative measure of the set is 0, so you can have parts in the given set, some has positive measure and some has negative and positive and negative, but when you add them all, you get a negative measure. Okay? So if a set has a negative measure, it's not necessary that it must be negative. But here's the interesting thing that you can observe, that if this and this has a negative measure and this has a positive measure, and this cumulative measure is negative, then we can show, that's the next lemma that we can prove, is that if you combine all these negative sets, this set has a subset that is a negative set actually. So the whole set may not be negative itself, but it must have a part that is negative.
The union of these. So
completely. Okay, it's not that, easy, but yes, somehow you can do it with that. Okay, if you take the given set and somehow roughly remove the positive parts out of it, okay, you're gonna remain, okay, the negative sets. But this is not a good picture, because these sets can be very weird set actually. So like this picture shows that, okay, you can partition a set into, something smoothly. So it's not, you can, we know that, measurable sets are pretty crazy sets. So here's a proposition. That I would like to prove next. And that would allow also me to prove, some important result. It probably will not be able to do today. Minus infinity to plus infinity. Okay. And let E be a measurable set. Such that mu of E is negative. Okay. Then find a subset of E measurable. Technical sense actually. You just don't have to treat them as positive or negative in the usual sense. So, like a set being positive and negative has a technical meaning. Alright? So, if I have a set that has negative measure, then it must have some part that is negative. That is negative actually. In the sense of the definition that is. Let's quickly run through the proof. Now, the first case would be that what if E is negative itself actually? Okay, so we have a set that is measurable and has a measure negative. Okay, nothing can stop him to be negative as well. So E may be a negative set itself. So if E is a negative itself, nothing to prove, because that's what is the subset that you want. Okay? Is negative, then nothing to prove. Simply take F to be E. The only interesting thing would be the case when E, we assume that E is not negative, let E is not negative. So if E is not a negative set, what does it mean?
There are parts of the...
Okay, so there is a part of it which has a positive
measure. Okay.
So by definition, we can say that there is a part of E that has a positive measure. So by definition, A1, the smallest positive integer, such that there is a set, So what essentially I want to say is that, okay, so there is a subset of E that has a positive measure. Okay? So if I have a subset of E that has a positive measure, then I can find a natural number such that the mu of E1 is bigger than or equal to 1 over M1. It should be simple. So it's like if mu of E is 2, then just take N1 to be 1 actually. It's 3, just take N1 to be 1. So if mu of E1 is 1/2, then okay, this will be a bigger integer. So you can always find such a natural number. Finding such a natural number is not a big number. Okay? So let N1 be the smallest integer. Okay, so that. Now, by the way, this is also not necessary that it should be the only E1 that is subset of E that has a positive measure. So you can have plenty of sets in set E that have the positive measure. Okay?
Yeah.
So in other words, similarly I can conclude or maybe get about